listening to Tank Talk presented by KGTropicals.
Thank you, CJ. Welcome, folks, to another episode of Tank Talk presented by KGTropicals, Universal Rocks, and Dustin's Fish Tanks. I am your host, John Hudson, coming at you every week to help you to take your love of fish keeping to the next level. You can contact the show by emailing me at kgtropicals@gmail.com, or you can call our message line at 1-540-709-1054. Now, we've got all kinds of stuff to talk about today. I've got some announcements. Some are good, some are bad. We've got an exciting John's World to talk about today, and then we're going to get into a really exciting topic, which is breeding fish. It's one of the most popular aspects of this hobby, and it's something that I could talk about for hours and hours and hours, but don't worry, folks. I'm not going to take up that much of your time, but let's get right into some announcements. New Algae is a product that's taking the fish world by storm due to its approach to maintaining a healthy aquarium. This approach will not only improve the look of your aquascape by gradually removing nuisance algae, it'll also increase the oxygen level in your tank, providing a much healthier environment for your fish. No other product on the market can make that claim. I've used New Algae in my tanks, and let me tell you, the results are fantastic. If you'd like to try New Algae in your aquarium, click the link in the description of this podcast where you'll find a special offer just for Tank Talk listeners. Give New Algae a try. Your tank and your fish will thank you for it. New Algae. Spend more time enjoying your aquarium and less time cleaning it.
John's World!
Okay, if you have been with us since the beginning of this podcast, John's World is going to be big for you. If you remember, I talked in episode one, in the very beginning of the episode, I talked about the fact that Lisa's 19-year-old son, I call him mine too, went off to Paris Island in South Carolina to go to boot camp for the Marine Corps. It was a big, big week for us. I don't know how I was able to get through doing a podcast that week, but it was a rough week. But I was very proud, and we've mentioned it a few times since then. Lisa was on episode 3 and we talked about it. This last 3 months has been a struggle for Lisa. I'm not going to lie. I mean, she has been a basket case when it comes to her oldest son, her firstborn child, being in boot camp. We got a call from him on Sunday. It was the first actual verbal communication that we've had with him since that awkward and weird phone call that we got from him the night that he got to boot camp. We actually got to sit there and talk to him for a little bit on Sunday. And the reason why we were able to do that was because he had just the day before completed the Crucible. If you're not familiar with the Marine Corps boot camp, they have a kind of grand finale to the boot camp, which is called the Crucible. Every military branch has one of these. They all call them different things, but the Crucible is I think it's like 54-hour practical exercise that every Marine Corps recruit goes through, and it is a test of everything that they've learned up to that point in boot camp. And if you want to know what they go through in the Crucible, it's pretty intense. Search it on YouTube. You'll find all kinds of information about the Crucible. It's a pretty big deal, and it's one of those things where I've seen multiple videos over the last few months of the Crucible, and when it's over, the Marine Corps does a big ceremony. It's a private ceremony. Nobody's allowed to be there, but it is where the drill instructors hand the new Marines their Eagle, Globe, and Anchor, which is their little medallion, I guess you would call it. I'm sorry if I'm calling it the wrong thing, but and this is to signify that they have gone from being a recruit to a Marine. And I've seen so many of these videos of those particular ceremonies, and every single Marine in that ceremony is crying, like crying profusely, because they do this right after the Crucible. So they've been put through this 54-hour siege of stress and exhaustion and lack of sleep and lack of food to finally make it to that moment at the end where they pass it and they are actually called Marine from their drill instructor for the first time is a really big deal. And after that, they get the they get some time off that day to relax. And then the next day, which was this past Sunday, they're able to make phone calls to home. And this is the first phone call we've got, like I said, since the beginning. And he called us and we got to have a nice conversation with him and it was really cool. But the reason why this is the big deal for us is because this is the week, folks. I'm leaving tomorrow. I'm actually recording this on October 21st, which I usually like to do these a week ahead. But again, last week was a bad week. I'm leaving tomorrow. Lisa's leaving today. I'm leaving tomorrow. We're heading down to South Carolina and, we're going to his graduation on Friday. And we're really excited about it. This is a big deal for him. We haven't seen him in 3 months. And I can't wait to see the man that he's become. When we talked to him on Sunday, he was different, but he was still his normal, goofy, silly self, which is good. I mean, I'm glad that, that they've matured him a little bit and taught him about responsibility, but maybe, you know, I didn't want them to turn him into a robot. And it doesn't seem like that is the case, but really looking forward to that. Sorry to ramble on here with you. We're already 15 minutes into this. But it is a really big deal for us. As you can imagine, any family who has had a sibling or a child in boot camp, this is what it's all about, is this week when they're graduating. And so we're really looking forward to going down there and seeing him. So thank you for letting me ramble on about that. Now, let me talk to you about my sponsors for this show, and then we will move into a really good topic of the day, which is breeding some fish. Okay, so it is time to talk about two of my favorite websites out there on the internet. We're talking about UniversalRocks.com and DustinsFishTanks.com. Folks, these two companies are offering deals to my listeners and my viewers on YouTube and on this podcast, deals that you will not get anywhere else. Now, first of all, UniversalRocks.com, if you're looking for that thing, that showpiece that you're going to put in your tank that's going to make your tank stand out above all of the others, you're going to want to go on to UniversalRocks.com. They've got handmade 3D backgrounds, decorative rocks, all different kinds of stuff. If you have a pond, they make stuff for waterfalls and all of these different things, folks. It's some of the coolest stuff you will ever see. You don't have to go any farther than my videos of my 240-gallon tank. You will see that background that I have in there. It's absolutely incredible. They have all different kinds of stuff like that on their site. And if you enter Tank Talk in the promo box at checkout, they're going to give you a 15% discount. You can't do any better than that. And let's talk about DustinsFishTanks.com. What's up, fish tank people? Dustin's Fish Tank, I can't do it as good as him. I'm not even going to try. If you're not familiar with Dustin, just type in his name for crying out loud. He's one of the biggest aquarium channels on YouTube, and he has his own website where he sells aquarium plants. Folks, go on DustinsFishTanks.com. Everything you need is right there on his site. If you want to have a live planted tank, absolutely gorgeous, you can get everything that you need from him. He's also got a brand new dirted tank guide if you want to check that out. It's something I would definitely recommend picking up. He is supposed to be sending me one. We'll see when that comes in. I'll be checking the mail. But if you enter Tank Talk and check out at DustinsFishTanks.com, he's not going to give you 15%. He's going to give you a 20% discount. Folks, are you kidding me? 20%. Who offers those kinds of discounts these days? Not very many people do, but Dustin is. So head over to UniversalRocks.com, DustinsFishTanks.com, put Tank Talk in the promo box at checkout and get you some nice big old discounts. All right. For the topic of the day today, we're going to talk about something that if you know anything about me, you know this is very near and dear to my heart. I talk about it all the time, and that is breeding fish. Now, let's face it, folks, any hobby that you have, and really anything in life, whether it's relationships, a job, a hobby, it doesn't matter. Things, if they go along normal routine, after a while, things start to get a little bit stale, and you've got to do something to spark it again, bring that passion back again, make you excited about your hobby or your job. We're not talking about jobs here. We're not talking about relationships. We're talking about the aquarium hobby. Sometimes you can get to that point where you're just kind of like, okay, there's my tank. There's my fish. They're really pretty. I take good care of them, but there's nothing really special about anything. And you might need that thing that's going to kind of bring that passion back again. Breeding fish is a great way to do that. If you're looking for something to just add to the hobby. It's one of the best extensions to this hobby that you can ever ask for, because it not only is facilitating the reproduction of these fish, but then you also have the fry to raise afterwards. And that's a lot of fun. That's, to me, one of the most fun parts of the whole process. Now, there are people like me who can have this happen by accident. I bred fish a long time ago. Back when I was a teenager, my early 20s, I bred angels, I bred convicts and, you know, plecos and things like that. But I didn't do anything really extravagant. It was just kind of one of those things that I did. But when I took a little hiatus, and then when I got back in and my fish, my African cichlids, accidentally spawned in my tank, it was like, oh man, it was like a whole nother world opened up. It happened by accident, but it is actually the reason why I'm sitting here talking to you right now. That's the effect that it had on the hobby for me. It didn't take it to the next level. It took it 10, 12 levels higher than it was before, because I had a whole new reason for doing this. I had a whole new way of looking at this hobby. So there's really nothing better that you can do with this hobby than to get into breeding if you're looking for something different than what you're used to doing. Now, of course, we all start out in fish keeping and we have one tank, singular, and then we want new fish. And so we go and buy another tank because they can't go together. And then we end up buying a third and a fourth. And eventually it's like you've got 8, 9 tanks and you got all the different kinds of fish you want. Now what are you going to do? Starting to breed them is something that can absolutely be that thing that takes it 3, 4 levels higher. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. There's a lot of different things when you're looking at breeding fish. There's a lot of different factors involved. Sometimes it can happen easily, like it did for me. When I was a kid and I bred convicts, I didn't do that on purpose either. When I bred angels, I didn't do that on purpose either. It just kind of happened. But once it happened, I took it to the next level and I started trying to facilitate it and make it happen. And it was a great extension to the hobby. But if your fish are not breeding by accident, and this is something that you want to do, you want to make this happen, we're going to talk about some of the things that you can do to help to facilitate that and actually make it easier and have it be something, like I said, that is a good extension for the hobby. A lot of these fish breed different ways. They need different things. They need different environments and different water parameters to be able to do things the right way. And so we're going to break a couple of them down. I mean, as many different types of fish as there are out there, I'm not going to be able to talk about all of them. We're going to take a couple of different types of fish and we're going to break down the things that you would need to do if you wanted to facilitate breeding in your tanks. And they're far different. This is why I chose the two that I chose. We're going to talk about breeding African cichlids, and we're going to talk about breeding discus and angels, because breeding discus and angels is very similar. It's not identical, but it's very similar what you would need to do to breed those. So we're going to put those in the same category and kind of break down what you would need to do to breed those. And then we're going to talk about how fun it is to breed live bearers towards the end. And then we'll get to Dana's question. So let's get right into breeding African cichlids. Now, if you know me at all, you know that that's kind of where I came from. I mean, my fish bred, Lisa and I went bananas over it. We decided to start a business, and now here we are. But if you are brand new to this, and you're wanting to breed African cichlids, the first thing that I would do is I would refer you to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/KGTropicals, all lowercase. Go over there, and I did an 8-part series. It was originally supposed to be 10, but it only ended up being 8, where I broke down every single aspect to breeding African cichlids. So you'll definitely want to go and check that out. We're going to cover almost everything that I talked about in that series, maybe not in quite as much detail. We're going to do it kind of briefly here. If you go over there and watch those, you'll get a better idea, and I'll be able to go in a little bit more detail. And oh, by the way, I did the same thing for discus and angels, but we'll talk about that in a minute. Now, the first thing that you need to think about when you're talking about breeding African cichlids. Now, I'm not going to talk about just putting a bunch of fish together and having them breed. I'm talking about you are somebody who you have decided you want to breed fish, period. and you've decided that African cichlids are what you want to breed, I'm going to walk you through things to think about to get you started and get you started successfully. Now, the first thing that you're going to want to do, obviously, is pick what type of fish you want to breed. With African cichlids, there is much, much variety. You're going to want to definitely do some investigating and find out what's going to be the fish, not that's easiest to breed, but what is going to be the easiest to get rid of. That's going to make a little bit more sense as we continue on. But find the right fish to breed. You can ask me. I'll give you my opinions on it. Watch my video. I give you some opinions there. There are a lot of fish to breed, and some are better than others because you may be wildly successful breeding one particular type of fish, an African cichlid, but nobody wants that fish. And so if you're not able to get rid of the fry, or, you know, get rid of them once they become juveniles, it's not going to be a very fun hobby because you're going to have a basement full of fish that you can't get rid of. So make the right decision as far as what kind of fish that you're going to breed. That's the first decision that you need to make. Now, the next thing that you need to know is African cichlids breed in groups. Some people call them colonies. I call them colonies. Most people call them colonies. But these are small groups of fish. They do not breed in pairs, folks. Now, this does not mean, please don't get confused, it doesn't mean that a bunch of fish get together and they create new fish. No. What it means is you will have one male that will facilitate several females. Yeah, that's every man's dream. I know. But I've never really been in that position, but I think that just looking at it from a common sense point, you might want to be careful what you wish for. I mean, if you got to satisfy... Okay, anyway. So they breed in groups. So you'll have one male, and then you'll have several females. Now, how many females you put in there is going to be based on how many fry you want to produce. If you just want to do this for fun and have some fry, maybe put three or four females in there. This is why we offer on our website, KGTropicals.com, selfish plug here, we offer breeding groups that is a male and three females. This is the perfect number for just casually breeding. You'll get some fry, you'll be happy, this will be fun, and everything will be great. If you're wanting to produce big numbers, my friend James Largo was on one of our Q&A episodes, and he started up a breeding operation out in Arizona. He wants as many fry as he can possibly get. He would not want to only put three females in there. He'd want to have a whole bunch of females in there and really make this male do his work to satisfy all of these females. The more females you put in there, the more fry is going to be produced. That's pretty much common sense. They do not breed in pairs, though, folks. I have so many people that email me or they order on our website one male, one female because they want to breed them. And it'll work. I'm not telling you that they won't do it. But if you put one male peacock and one female peacock in a tank, more than likely what you're going to end up with is a dead female and the male in there by himself because he will focus all of his attention on dominating that female, showing that female that he has big muscles and he is the boss, and he will inevitably end up killing that female. We know that African cichlids do much better in larger groups as far as just a community of fish together. They like to be in larger groups. Breeding is no different. There needs to be a little bit of chaos. There needs to be a lot of action in the tank to keep the male at bay, to keep him from wanting to just brutalize these females. So that's the first thing that you need to know when it comes to African cichlids is that they breed in groups. Now, if you're somebody who's starting a fish farm and you've got all kinds of tanks and you're ready to really go after this, then you might have a huge tank with 10, 12 males in there and 100 females. You can do that. But if you're doing this at home and you're just setting up one breeding tank, you'll want to have a male and multiple females. Again, the more females you have, the more likelihood there is that you're going to get more fry. Now, let's talk about the tank size. Tank size is up for debate. If you watch that video series that I put out there, you're going to see that I told you that you should have a minimum of a 29-gallon tank. Now, this was 2 years ago that I said that, and I'm not telling you that that was wrong, but what I am telling you is that what I'm going to recommend to you today is different than that. And the main reason for it is just because it's just nicer. I'm going to recommend if you're going to breed African cichlids that you have a minimum of a 55-gallon tank for your breeding tank. This tank is going to be used exclusively for the purposes of being the breeding room. This is where all of the action happens. This is the master bedroom. This is the vibrating bed. This is the place that all of the magic happens. And so give them a large enough tank to where the females can get away from the males, because they're not going to stop pursuing the females. And it just gives them a little bit more room to spread their wings and do what they got to do. 55-gallon minimum peacocks and imbunas. If you're going to breed haps, depending on what type of hap you're breeding, you're going to want to go into a much larger tank. Just as an example, Venustis. If you want to breed Venustis, folks, these are fish that can get 10 inches. They need to be in a much larger tank, significantly larger than a 55-gallon. So just keep that in mind. It should be common sense, but, you know, most people, and I don't blame them, most people that get into breeding, they want to do it kind of on the cheap because, you know, they're just looking to add something to the hobby. They don't want to dump a bunch of money into it. If that is the case for you, I probably wouldn't recommend starting to breed things like Venustis or Buconotos or Living Stone Eye, these fish that get really big, Fuscos. You don't want to do that because you're going to need to spend a lot more money to get them a much bigger tank. If you're just getting started and you want to do it on the cheap, breed peacocks and imbunas. You'll be much better off. So 55-gallon tank at the minimum is what you're going to want to do. Now, as far as getting the active breeding colonies, I have found that there is no strategy to it whatsoever. Just about every male is going to be compatible with just about every female. What I recommend everybody do is if you go to websites like mine, where I can sell you a guaranteed male. This is a male. I promise. I guarantee you that this is a male. Some websites don't do that. They only sell them unsexed. I can sell you a male directly, and then I can sell you as many females as you want. So what I recommend as far as setting up your first breeding group, I think this is absolutely critical, folks. You need one male to do the breeding, but I'm going to recommend that you buy two. Here's why. The first male might be a bruiser. He might be a spousal abuser. He might be shooting blanks. He might not be mature enough to know how to do what he's doing, or he might just do it wrong. It's nice to be able to have that backup there just in case. So what I tell people is get you two males, put one male in another tank. I'm sure this is not going to be your only tank. So you probably have a community African cichlid tank. And just for the purposes of this conversation, let's talk about German Reds. No, because I think that's what I did on the video. Let's talk about Red Top Lawandas. How about that? Okay. One of the most popular peacocks out there. You've decided you want to breed Red Top Lawandas. I would recommend you buy two males, put one in your show tank, put one in your breeding tank, and then give that one in your breeding tank a whole bunch of females and let it ride. See what happens. See if things actually work out. And if they don't, you have that male that's a backup that you can swap them. You can put, I know that sounds weird when we're talking about breeding, but you can take the one male out of the breeding tank and put him in your show tank, and then take the one that's in your show tank, put him in the breeding tank, and see if that one knows how to treat a lady. I always recommend that, because if this one's shooting blanks or if this one just doesn't know what he's doing, then, you know, you go to buy another male, there might not be one available. Or, you know, who knows what the case is. You might buy one that's way too small. You never know. It's good to have that backup. In this hobby, I believe everything should have a backup. So if you want a foolproof way of doing this, get yourself a backup male. But if you can't afford one, that's fine. Just get your one male and get your multiple females, put them in the tank, and they will do their thing. Now, we do need to talk about the setup of the tank, the parameters, and all of that good stuff. African cichlids like a lot of current. You know that. The current, though, in a breeding tank can actually work against the whole process, because with African cichlids, what they do, they go through a breeding ritual where the male and the female goes around in circles on the bottom of the tank. They're substrate egg layers. So they're going to find something that is horizontal. It could be on the bottom of the tank. It could be the top of a flower pot. It could be whatever. They're going to lay their eggs on a flat surface. And while they're doing that, they're going to go around in circles. The female's going to lay the eggs and then she's going to pick them up in her mouth. So if you have a lot of current, I've actually seen this happen. The eggs can actually get blown away and the female maybe only gets a couple in her mouth. And you just lost all of those eggs because once they get blown away, all of the other fish swoop in and eat them. So you want to keep everything contained. The male is actually going to define an area in the tank where he wants to do the bulk of his spawning. And what I have seen is that the male will pick a spot that doesn't have a lot of current and he'll clear it out and he'll get it ready, but you never really know. So you want the surface of the water to be highly agitated. You want that to have a lot of current, but maybe at the bottom of the tank, you don't want the current to be moving as much. Decorations in the tank, not really all that necessary. I mean, some people believe that you really need a place for the other females to retreat to. Okay, I'm not going to argue with that. That's totally fine. If you want to put in some flower pots or something like that, and when I talk about flower pots, I'm talking about the terracotta flower pots. They're orange. What a lot of people do, including me, is they take those and they turn them upside down or they turn them sideways. Obviously, if you turn it upside down, you need to cut a hole into it. But this gives a nice little cave for the fish to retreat to. It's a good thing. I mean, I don't think it's absolutely necessary, but it's a good thing to have something like that in there. Substrate. In a breeding tank, folks, the male is going to do what he wants to do with the substrate. So if you buy an expensive sand or, you know, some kind of expensive substrate and put it in there, the male's going to move it around because he's going to clear out his spot to do their spawning. Now, you can set up spawning sites, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that's what the male is going to use. You can do things like have your substrate, but then lay down some rocks, flat rocks, and, you know, maybe the male will pick one of those spots. He may not, but that usually works out pretty good. So minimal substrate is fine, or even no substrate at all in your breeding tank is actually ideal, because then the male doesn't have to do any work. He can get right to wooing those females and getting them to do what they do. So hiding spots, sure, do that. Substrate, not necessary. If you have to put something in there, just understand that the male is going to move it all around, and you want the bottom of the tank to not have as much current. You don't want those eggs getting blown away. And then as far as water parameters go, we know that African cichlids like a high pH. They like their water to be nice and hard. They like their water to be clean. And the temperature for breeding, it would be a good idea to raise it up a little bit higher than what you're used to. There's a lot of reasons why temperature should be higher, but a higher temperature is going to be one of those things that's going to really make the females feel nice and loose and feel good and ready to go. So if you normally keep your tanks at 80 degrees, maybe raise it up to 82 in your breeding tank, and that'll definitely help to get them moving a little bit faster. And then keep the water clean. That should be written on every single tank. It's in every rule book. The number one rule in fish keeping, that doesn't matter what you're doing, is keep the water clean. A happy environment for the fish is going to make them breed more. So keep them in nice, clean, warm water, and they will be ready to go. But as far as the parameters, the hardness and all of that kind of stuff, it's the same as it would be if you were just keeping them normal. So get your water straight, get the temperature up a little bit, and that should help them to get going. That's kind of like putting on a nice Barry White album. To have the water perfect is kind of like doing that. It really gets the juices flowing and gets them rolling. So clean water, warm, and just look and watch and wait for it to happen, because it will. So you've got them in a nice clean tank. You've got the Barry White music playing, which would be nice, clean, warm water. Everything is all set up. And what do? Well, you're basically going to sit back and wait at that point. You're going to wait for the females and the male to do their thing. What African cichlids are going to do, I'm not going to go into the whole spawning process again, but they're going to perform their little ritual, and the female is going to pick the eggs up in her mouth. She's going to hold them in her mouth for a period of 18 to 21 days, depending on what you're breeding. Some may hold longer, like Frontosas can hold their eggs in their mouth for much, much longer. Frontosas do everything slower than other fish. So just know that going in if you're going to breed frontosas. It's one of the more difficult African cichlids to breed. We're not going to get into that, but they can be, and they do everything slower. So they're one of the ones that would hold the eggs longer. But the female is going to hold the eggs in her mouth while they develop into fry. They start out as eggs, and the fry actually develop on the outside of the egg, and then the fry consumes the egg. It doesn't eat the egg. It just, the egg is consumed naturally, and the egg actually turns into the fry's digestive system. Now, I know that might sound really weird and crazy, but just picture the egg with a little fry attached to it. And that egg is going to continually get smaller and smaller and smaller until where it is completely consumed and you have a little fry. Now, all of this is going to happen in the female's mouth. The whole time this is going to happen, and you can't see it happen unless you have a female who is generous and she comes to the glass and slightly opens her mouth and you can see the fry in her mouth and you can see what's going on. But usually at the 18 to 21 day mark, if she does that, what you're going to see is a bunch of little eyeballs in that mouth looking out at you. Now, it's said, I've read, I don't know this is fact because I was not around hundreds of thousands of years ago, but it's said that mouth brooding is not how these fish originated. They originated being substrate egg layers, and they would protect the fry like most of your South and Central American cichlids would do. But they evolved into being mouth brooders because so many other fish were coming in and stealing and eating the fry. And so the females believed that this was a more secure way of rearing their fry, and keeping them safe was to keep them in their mouth. So they keep them in their mouth the whole time until they are free swimming fry. And then what happens is the female will spit them out. If you're lucky, you will be there to see this happen. It is a spectacular thing to watch the female go ahead and release the fry. It is really neat. She will spit them out, and then she will stay by. The fish will stay in kind of a tight little ball, and not tight. They'll start to explore a little bit, but the female will stay close by to make sure that everything is okay. And then if there is a sign of danger, I don't know how she does it. I don't know if it's some kind of sonar or some kind of noise that she makes or what. But if there is a sign of danger, all of those fry will just immediately swim back into her mouth. And it's one of the coolest things that I've ever seen, because the fish, you can see them. They go up to her mouth and they're just sitting there patiently waiting for her to either open her mouth or wait for all of the brothers and sisters to get in. And then they go in. It's really neat to see that happen. Now, this is what leads us to our next conversation, is what to do with these females, because it is a scary thing. If you have this breeding tank and you've got a whole bunch of fish in there and the female is holding the fry, what's going to happen when she spits them out? Well, there's going to be a lot of activity going on, because if the other fish that are in the tank see that there's little fry, they're going to want to eat them. Even the father of those fry will eat the fry. So this is a big concern if you're really trying to breed these fish, whether it be for a profit or to sustain the hobby, whatever it is, you're wanting to save these fry. You don't want them to get eaten. So this is what leads us to our next topic, and that is rearing tanks or egg tumblers. Okay, this is the biggest thing in the African cichlid breeding world. What to do when there is a holding female? If you leave the female in your breeding tank to naturally carry out her pregnancy and naturally spit the fry, you're going to lose a lot of fry. You're going to lose them for a lot of reasons. One, we talked about, the other fish can swoop in and eat them. Or what can happen is the female at any moment can get spooked. And if she gets spooked, she can spit the fry out or swallow them. They actually believe, and angels and discus are this way too, they actually believe that swallowing them and eating them is keeping them safe. So you do have these risks. So what a lot of people do is they will take the female once they see that the spawning process has taken place, and you can visibly see that she has a mouthful of eggs, and you can see this because her throat will be bulging. It's actually called a buccal cavity. I believe I'm pronouncing that word right. I've never heard it said. I've only read that word. I've never heard it said by anybody that knows more than I do. They have this cavity in their throat that holds these eggs. It's kind of like a pelican. You'll be able to see very clearly that the female has eggs in their mouth. And what people will do, and I've done this before in the past, is they will remove the female from the breeding tank at that point and put them into a fry tank. This is a rearing tank, a fry tank, a smaller tank, a 10-gallon tank, if you will, or it could even be a 5-gallon tank, and put that female in the tank by herself. One of the first questions is going to be, well, how long do you wait? How long do you wait to put the female in there? With most African cichlids, all African cichlids, I would say give it 4 or 5 days. What you're wanting is for the eggs to take. You're wanting everything to be settled. The female still has them in her mouth after 4 or 5 days. That's pretty much telling you that it's a good batch of fry. If something didn't take, if the male didn't do his job and the eggs are bad, then the female will spit them out and it's all done with. But if after 4 or 5 days, if she still has them in her mouth, then you can feel confident that they're a good batch and you can go ahead and take her out and put her into a tank all by herself where she'll be nice and comfortable, stress-free. A lot of people will actually even paint the sides of the tank and the back or cover them up with paper so that there's no outside interference threatening that female so that she doesn't accidentally spit them. And they will hold that female in the tank for the entire duration of her pregnancy. Now, this is good for two reasons. One, if you're wanting to do this the natural way, which is let the female hold the eggs throughout the entire gestation period, she's not going to eat throughout this whole time because she has a mouthful of eggs. There's going to be people that are going to say, I've seen my females eat. No, what you've seen her do is try to eat, but with a mouthful of eggs, she's not going to eat, folks. So the female's going to be really skinny. So if you have her in there and she releases the fry and the fry are now free swimming fry, she's going to be really hungry and she's going to be really skinny and really frail. And so feeding her while you're feeding your fry in that fry tank is a good thing because it gives her an opportunity to get her strength up so that she can be put back into the breeding tank. I usually, when we were doing it this way, I would give the female a week or so, feed her up, fatten her up real good before you put her back into the tank. Not only is she going to be really hungry, but she's going to be very malnourished because she hasn't eaten anything in the last 3 weeks. So it gives her an opportunity to get her strength back, get feeling good again, and then you can put her back into your breeding tank and leave the fry in the fry tank to start growing and start to become juveniles, which you can then sell or put into your show tank or whatever it is that you want to do. There is another method, and this is the method that we currently use, and that would be to artificially incubate those eggs. Now, why would you want to do this? We talked about earlier, there's a lot of ways that your female can get spooked and prematurely spit or swallow the eggs. This eliminates that threat. There's also the fact that you're going to get more fry if you artificially incubate the eggs. Why? Because as soon as you remove those eggs from the female, she recovers. She starts to go right back into reproduction mode, and she will spawn again with the male faster than if you let this entire process go. You remove the eggs from her mouth, and she immediately forgets about them. They're now gone. It's no longer part of my life. I'm going to go right back into being a reproducing female mode. So for people like me that want to get as much fry as possible, artificially incubating the eggs is going to be the way to go. You're going to get more fry, and it's going to be less intrusive on the female because, like we said earlier, she's going to hold those eggs for 3 weeks, and during that 3-week period, she's not eating. So she's not going to go through that 3 weeks. She's going to maybe go a few days and then she'll be able to start eating again and she'll never get skinny and frail. So again, allowing her to reproduce faster. Now, how do we do this? It's a process called stripping the eggs from the female's mouth. It doesn't sound, it's not as bad as it sounds. It sounds like something that's cruel and unusual. Believe me, it's not. And there is no way to describe it by way of podcast. However, good for you. I've got a video on this process. It's one of the first videos that I did, and it's one of the most watched videos on my channel. If you go to my channel and go all the way down to the bottom of the videos page, you will see a video that is called Stripping African Cichlid Eggs. It's a very simple process to do. If you feel weird about having a fish in your hand, then you might not want to even watch that video. But it's a very simple, it's not going to hurt her. I lost my word there. It's not going to hurt the female. It's very easy, very gentle. And you actually remove the eggs from the female, and you raise the eggs in what's called an egg tumbler. This is basically an African cichlid egg incubator. That's what an egg tumbler is. This is a vessel that you put the eggs into, and you gently roll the eggs by using bubbles of air. You roll the eggs in this tumbler so that they do not sit down and rot. And this allows these fry to develop in the egg tumbler as opposed to developing in her mouth. And like I said, for me, this is what I do. I do it because my female only goes a few days without eating, which is less intrusive on her. It eliminates the threat of there being unforeseen circumstances that spook the female and cause her to prematurely abort the pregnancy. And it keeps my females stronger and healthier so that they can spawn again faster. So these are all the reasons why I am someone who believes in stripping the females. Now, if you're just doing this for fun, then I would do it the natural way. If you're just doing this for fun, I would do it. I would use the method of removing the female from the breeder tank, putting her into her own fry tank. It can be a 10, 5, whatever you want, a small tank just for her. It's her little maternity ward. You put her in there and you let nature take its course. Now, there is an argument against artificially incubating the eggs. I'm sorry, again, I lost it a little bit. We're going on 50 minutes here, so I've been going for a while, but there is an argument against it, and I think it's a valid argument, and I don't know that it's fact, but there are articles out there to support this argument, and that is eggs that develop into fry the natural way in the mother's mouth, in her buccal cavity, and then those fry are released by the female, taken back in by the female. This is parenting. This is the mother of these eggs doing her job as a mother. Now, she's only going to do this for a few days, and then she's going to completely lose any and all interest in these fry. And I've even seen females eat their own fry. So, you know, once that happens, you need to get the female out because she can turn against them in a heartbeat. But the argument is that the eggs that are developed in the mother's mouth the natural way will produce better breeding babies, because they have that instinctive parenting instinct. Good Lord, I might have to edit that out. They have that parenting instinct in them because they've actually experienced that. If you artificially incubate these eggs, they don't have that. They just come out of a machine, and they don't have that instinct in them to rear their eggs. And so, therefore, they will not be as good of breeders. Now, I don't think it's a bad argument, but I don't necessarily agree with it, because I have seen eggs that I have incubated in egg tumblers and raised them up to be full-grown adults that have become very good breeders for me. So I don't necessarily know where I stand on it. I'm not going to disagree with it. I'm not going to say it's a bad argument. I think it's probably pretty valid. I think somebody much smarter than me has done some investigating on that and probably come to a conclusion. But as far as I'm concerned, for being a breeder that wants as many eggs as possible, I believe using egg tumblers is the way to go. But if you're doing this just for fun, just to see this happen, it's great to get kids involved with breeding these fish, then I would say let nature take its course and do it the natural way. Let the female hold those eggs for the whole gestation period, and then release them and do it the natural way. That is going to be the most fun. Now, I have to confess something here to you folks. I went into this episode thinking that I was going to be able to talk about breeding fish as a whole, make one big nice episode all about breeding all of these different kinds of fish. And what I've realized is I run my mouth a lot, and that doesn't leave me a whole lot of time to actually talk about all of these things. I would rather break this up and do a couple of different episodes rather than make this really long. So what we're going to do here is we're going to actually go ahead and cut this breeding series off. We're going to make a series out of it, and I think that that will be a lot more fun. So we just talked about breeding African cichlids. That was a good time. We're going to talk about breeding discus and angels next week, and then the episode after that, we will get into raising all of the fry. We may be able to do discus and angels and raising the fry in one episode. I'm not going to make this a five-part series or anything like that that I did with Fishkeeping 101. But, you know, I went into this thinking that I was just going to do all of this in one episode, and there's just way too many things to talk about to do it in one-hour block. We're already over an hour here, and we haven't even gotten into discus and angels yet. So next week we will get into setting yourself up to be a discus or angel breeder, and then we will get into raising the fry either in an episode after that or in the same episode, depending on how long I run my mouth. So let's get into this question here from Dana, and we'll see if we can't answer this for her.
Hi, John. This is Dana out in Sacramento, California. Love all of your endeavors, and I am patiently waiting for that 75-gallon to pop up on Craigslist so I can have my Mbuna tank, and I'll order them all from you. My question has to do with wild versus farm-raised cichlids. In addition to my Mbuna tank, I would like to keep a South or Central American cichlid, informally called the Cupid cichlid. I can't find them anywhere on the web except from a seller on eBay. The seller states that they are wild-caught. Are there any differences to be aware of in ordering and housing wild-caught versus farm-raised fish or cichlids in particular? Thanks for everything you do. Take care. Bye-bye.
Well, thank you, Dana. I can't wait to see your order come through for your Mbunas. Good luck on your search for the 75-gallon tank. Now, wild-caught versus tank-raised, there is a lot of difference between those. I sell fish for a living, and I have not heard of this Cupid cichlid. Silly me. I don't know if it's a common fish out there, but, well, if it was common, I probably would have heard about it. So I don't think it's common, but anyway, if there is somebody that has them that are wild-caught and they're selling them on eBay, I don't know. I don't know how that makes me feel. I mean, it makes me feel a little bit strange. I'm just being honest with you. But, you know, anybody looking at my website might think it's a little strange that I'm selling African cichlids on there. I don't know. But I don't know enough about this person to know whether I'm comfortable with that or not. But to talk about the differences between wild-caught and farm-raised, there really is only one difference as far as I'm concerned, and that is when you initially get the fish. What did the supplier that you're getting them from, what did they do prior to selling you these fish? Here's what I mean. We deal with a company in Homestead, Florida called Old World Exotics. We also deal with a company called Florida Exotic Fish Sales. And both of these companies, they are farms that raise their own fish, that we buy all the time, but then they also have wild caught fish that they deal with. And when they bring these fish in, they put them into their facility. They do not put them in with the fish that they're raising on their farm. They put them in a completely different section and they clean them out for a couple of weeks. When I say clean them out, I mean they have medications in the in the water if necessary. They fast them, they clean them out, they empty them out, and they get them on their type of food, and they monitor these fish for a couple of weeks before they ever even make them available to us, and then allowing us to make them available direct to the consumer. So they do their job of making sure that these fish are good and healthy before they sell them to us. The reason why I bring that up is if it's a company that I'm not familiar with and I don't know what they do with their fish before they send them from Lake Malawi straight to us, you don't know what you're getting yourself into, or the Amazon or whatever they're pulling their fish from. You don't know what is coming with those wild caught fish. There are so many parasites and funguses and bacteria and all different kinds of crap that come from those rivers and lakes that you're going to be putting that straight into your tank. So that's the biggest concern with wild fish, wild caught fish, is what they bring with them. If you're dealing with a reputable supplier that quarantines them prior to selling them to you, that's great. Or if you have your own ability to quarantine them, that would also be a good thing. The other big difference between wild caught versus farm raised is your water parameters better be spot on, meaning your hardness, your pH, and all of that, because that's what this fish is used to. And if you put them in something completely different, they might not be used to that, and they may not do well in that environment. This is the whole thing, the four argument for farm raised, is because these fish have been raised in tap water. They've been raised in water that your fish is used to, the same kind of water that you have, versus a fish that's taken out of Lake Tanganyika and put into your tap water in San Diego. You know what I'm saying? There is a big difference there. So the process of getting them acclimated to your water is kind of a big deal. And the process of getting them cleaned out so that they're not bringing any kind of harmful parasites or anything like that, and introducing it into your tank, those are the two biggest things. But as far as the temperament of the fish and, you know, the appearance of the fish and all of that kind of stuff, there's not a whole lot of difference. I mean, well, when we're talking about African cichlids, they're not all that much of a difference. When you deal with South American cichlids and things like that, the wild-caught fish actually look far different than the standard tank-raised fish. Well, I guess tank-raised wouldn't be the standard way, would it? When your fish are tank-raised, usually they're strains that have been developed for years and years and years and years and actually improved. A lot of times people will call wild-caught fish kind of dull and kind of drab because their colors haven't been developed over the years by these farmers. So appearance in South and Central American cichlids with wild caught, they can be pretty different than what you're used to seeing from your farm raised fish. So, but with Africans, not so much, because they're pretty much the same. There are certain strains that are not available in the lake. They're only available through farms, and that's because they've been developed exclusively by that farm. So, you know, there's a lot of things to think about when it comes to wild caught, but I think that the primary things that you need to be thinking about are, what is that fish bringing with them? And what are the water parameters? Is that fish going to do okay in your water? Because what they're used to is the water that they were born in the Amazon River. So I hope that wasn't too overwhelming. I hope that makes sense. It's not all that complicated when it comes to getting wild caught fish. Usually you will pay a little bit more for them, but you know, if you're into that kind of thing, then cool. If that's the only way that you're able to get them, then, you know, do what you got to do. But I would have a quarantine tank and make sure that that fish is good and healthy before you introduce them into your main community tank. So thank you all so much for watching this watching. Are you watching this or are you listening to it? Thank you for listening to this episode. This has been a lot of fun. Like I said, I'm going to go ahead and turn this into a series. I think it's going to be easier to do it that way, because then I'm not cutting things off and making it too short. Probably just going to be a two-part series, but you know, it may go across into part three. So be looking forward to next week's episode, where we're going to talk about breeding discus and angels, and then we're going to get into raising the fry of both African cichlids and discus, because the water parameters might be a little bit different, but really the concept of raising fry is the same. So we will get into all of that stuff next week. I look forward to it. Be aware of what's going on with the Q&A series, folks. If you want to see that continue on and you know, continue on in video and podcast form, then get those questions in now, kgqanda@gmail.com, or call our message line at 1-540-709-1054, and we can keep those series alive and continue to have fun with it. On a last note here, folks, don't forget to support our sponsors, universalrocks.com, DustinsFishTanks.com, and of course, yours truly, KG Tropicals. We've got our Amazon affiliate links up there now. All different kinds of stuff is available on our website, as well as live fish too. Don't forget about that. So thank you for supporting our sponsors. Thank you so much for supporting this show. I look forward to talking to you next week. Have a wonderful day, and we'll see you next week.